All right. Well, welcome everybody back to the Rice Report here. I apologize for the delay. I'm trying to get into a system where I can produce content for you every night. Sometimes it gets difficult. I'm not a professional. I'm not an expert in anything either. I'm just a normal guy in a hoodie talking to all of you, trying to make sense of this crazy world that we live in. And I hope our last episode provided a lot of information financially. I will reiterate that this show, we focus on the three things that the powers that be tell you should never talk about: money, politics, and religion, because they all make sense when coordinated. If you're making a decision on money, whatever that investment is, should align with your politics and your faith. Goes with any of the other three. Now, one thing that has really, really come to light in the last couple of days since we were on the last time on one of these shows is the fact that censorship still exists. I have recently seen that we're a small show, just normal people here, but we had 900 some odd views that in the blink of an eye went down to 379. So we're way over target. I think that we're talking about things they don't want you to know about, so we're going to keep doing it. Also brings to mind that most of you are probably watching me on YouTube. I'm also available, or the show is available, on Spotify, iHeartRadio, iTunes, and Rumble. So if you're interested, any of those other platforms are not doing the same. I like being on YouTube because this is where a lot of people get lost, and I want to help them figure out how to find their way home just by understanding the world that we live in. So important these days. So let's hop into it. Got a few great topics for you here today. We're going to go through some basic financial information. You got to understand money. If you don't understand money, especially at turbulent times like this, you're going to find yourself in a rut and your family in a bad position. I don't want that for any of you. So we're going to talk a little bit about money. We're going to go through the Bitcoin halving. What is the Bitcoin halving? We are going to do a Bitcoin show in the next few episodes. I can't really commit to which day because I do work a full-time job. This is not my job. But we're also going to be talking about some of the things that are happening on our border. And things that are happening around this country from a very suspicious point of view on electronic infrastructure, electronic devices, and our 911 system. A lot of things happen every single day. It's difficult to keep pace with them. It's difficult to follow through to understand exactly all the items you need to know to live your life and make good decisions, which is exactly why we do these shows for you here. So first and foremost, we just authorized more money going out to Ukraine. We are authorizing money to go to Israel. I think it's $26.3 billion to Israel. I want to remind all of you that with the recent attack in Iran, with all those missiles fired, not a single person was killed. The way that this works when you have a military-industrial complex that is very close to the money printer of the Federal Reserve, they find a way to make a lot of money. So I know that there are definitely people who want to support Israel. They want to support Taiwan. They want to support Ukraine. And I'm not going to say you shouldn't. We should all be supporting humanity as a whole, but we should also be less naive, less gullible in the world. It was very interesting earlier today. Congressman Waltz questioned our military-industrial complex about their pricing for things. And I'm going to go through that in just a moment. But I will remind you that we're getting ready to send $26 billion of our money to a country that experienced zero casualties in an attack. Not to say that they won't in the future, but Israel is a very prosperous nation and has very capable military defenses and probably the best technological surveillance system in the world. Matter of fact, from Tel Aviv or anywhere within Israel, they can literally watch me through the camera that I'm talking to you on. And they have a very sophisticated border system. Not to say I don't support Israel or I support humanity in all ways. I support peace. We should all be supporting peace, but peace sometimes is not a possibility. But nonetheless, as American citizens, we should understand that they're getting ready to send right now for sure $26 billion up to $91 billion to foreign countries to protect their borders. In fact, Speaker Johnson just gave $300 million to Ukraine so they could enforce their borders. Would be nice if that happened here, and I'm going to go through the border situation as is, what I know. Again, I'm not an expert, I'm not an insider, I don't know anything, I'm just a normal guy. I'm a nobody, a complete nobody in this world. I happen to have a lot of friends who are somebodies who help me out to understand some things from time to time. Now, when we look at this tax situation that we all just went through on tax day, we have to look at the government spending because that's what we're paying back. We're not financing roads. We're not financing schools. That's done with other taxes. What we are doing is financing a luxurious lifestyle for the military-industrial complex and everyone in Washington, D.C., and that's just a fact. Now, there are a few things that are happening right now that are very confusing to the common person who's not paying attention to all the intricacies of international business, international trade. Not that I am, but I pay attention more than most. One of those things right now is the IMF. If you don't know who the IMF is or the BIS is kind of like the central bank of central banks. The IMF is really no different. They're very influential, the International Monetary Fund. They came out in the last 3 days and said two things that totally blew my mind. Those two things were very simple. Number one, a few days ago, they actually told the nation of El Salvador, who has totally turned itself around from thousands of murders per year to a handful of murders, and they have legalized Bitcoin as a legal tender. Well, the IMF, just to show you what is happening in the world, the IMF actually just held back a $1.4 billion development funding for El Salvador with the request that they deny their legal status of Bitcoin. And for those of you who don't understand Bitcoin, which is almost everyone, we are going to walk through this. I could do a four-hour show on it because I didn't pay attention to it at all. I actually gave a terrible speech 10 years ago because someone asked me to fill in for somebody else. I didn't know anything, and I thought it was a stupid idea. But now, after the last 2 years, when most of the world was trying to figure out the shape of the earth, I was digging into the stuff and meeting people all around the world. This is a very important topic in the world. It's not just what did Jamie Dimon call it today? He called it a pet rock or a Ponzi. So when a guy who runs all the central banks in the world hates something, I immediately like it because he has 0% of your best interest in mind. But the IMF also came out and made a prediction. That prediction was that the Russian economy will outperform all advanced economies in the coming years. That sounds very strange to me. All I keep hearing is that Putin is terrified of us, that these sanctions are destroying him. Yet the IMF, who is not friendly to Putin, came out and said that the Russian economy will advance beyond all or will outperform all advanced economies in the coming years. Now, they are also the second largest miner of Bitcoin in the world, so they're going to see this redundant pattern of, you know, the term cryptocurrency will be used, but I'll get into Bitcoin at the end of the show. But the IMF is now coming out and saying that. They're also coming out and saying that Russia and the BRICS nations are accelerating their adoption of crypto payments for international settlements. Now, there are a million companies that provide this, and they'll all claim, you know, a stake on who's going to do it. I don't know that they'll use anything but Bitcoin or their own cryptocurrency. Central banks have been building blockchains and building their own currencies for about 8 to 10 years behind closed doors. That's a fact. But we also see in the economy, that's the foreign economy. This is a very exciting time because we're very early in this crypto market, and we're very late to standard, logical, sane thinking. So they might collide at the exact right time. We're also seeing layoffs in this country accelerate. We're now over 74,000 full-time jobs have been lost just in the month of April. So that's 18 days, 74,000 full-time jobs. Will they be replaced by migrants? I don't know. Migrants are taking part-time jobs all over the country right now, and that's really where all of our job growth is coming from. We're also seeing layoffs at companies like Google, IBM, S&P, all over the board. There's no one that'll be held back from an economic downturn and layoffs of salaried employees. Now, for me personally, and I know some of you will laugh at this, but I'm very sad to hear that Red Lobster is going out of business. They're preparing to declare for bankruptcy. It doesn't mean they're going to shut down. They'll restructure. But for me and my wife, that was a place when we didn't have much money as college students. That was always kind of our nice night out, our luxury night out on the town was Red Lobster. So I hope that they stay in business. I hope that that happens. Now, Wall Street has many different stories. So despite the fact it may look like nothing is happening, that just corruption is running wild and the darkness is winning in every category, that's simply not true. And we're going to end today's show on a positive note like with that. But exposure is a big part of the process we're in. There has to be exposure to problems, pressure applied by a society to get answers. And then you have disclosure and then you have change. That's the process I believe that happens. Exposure, pressure, disclosure, change. One of the things that was exposed by Congress, which is shocking that it was Congress to begin with, is the fact that BlackRock, along with many other Wall Street firms for the last 4.5 to 10 years, there's no real date on it, that they've been sending billions and billions of dollars from retirement funds and mutual funds to blacklisted companies in China. So if my last episode about a Maoist revolution didn't hit home, and you deny it and say, oh, he's crazy, he's a conspiracy theorist. It's absolutely true. We've been financing China. China would not be where they are without the assistance of American politicians growing their political and economic power. And that continues today with all this funneling of your retirement funds into Chinese companies that are blacklisted in this country. Now, the energy sector is really, really important and really interesting. So being that I'm in oil and gas, I follow this stuff very closely. Was that a year and a half ago? Well, whenever the Nord Stream 1 and 2 pipelines blew up, I came to the office and everyone asked me, Eric, who did it? And I said, we did. And I didn't bat an eye. And I still don't bat an eye. And there's enough evidence now to prove that it was correct. So in the past couple of years, what's happened is we've essentially shut down our ability to liquefy natural gas at the same time that natural gas spiked in Europe. And when it went to $30 a unit and it only cost $2 a unit to produce it in America, there was no way of small producers around this country to be able to export and make those profits. So those profits have created a false rise in the GDP of this country. That's a fact at this point. Now, the interesting thing about oil and any trading market that you have to understand is that in the stock market and a lot of the futures market, about 90% of all trading occurs algorithmically, meaning that there's not, you know, the guy smoking a cigarette on the New York Stock Exchange floor waiting to place trades with paper. It's all electronic, and most trades are set with parameters. So an algorithmic trade would be, as an example, I want to buy IBM at $45. When it hits $45, you purchase for me. That's what an algorithm would do. Algorithms take in information from government sources because they're supposed to be trusted, and they trade based on that. So when there's a good jobs report, your algorithms are buying, so on and so forth. It's how algorithms work in a market. Now, in trading and futures, especially energy, it's a very low algorithm. Now, most large traders, especially in the commodity space, they're backed by central banks. That's where they get a primary source of funding to be able to trade with, the big ones. And these are the big guys that don't have articles in Forbes. These are the guys who really control the market. And a bunch of them just teamed up in the last couple of days, and they put up 3 million barrels of oil on penny options at $250 per barrel. So I'm not saying anything is going to change from that happening, but what I am saying is that the winds of change are coming, and the ability to see how markets are manipulated is about to be exposed in front of your eyes. A barrel of oil is a barrel of oil. The price of a barrel of oil is determined by supply and demand theoretically, but is supply and demand a real, can you trust supply numbers? I don't at this point, at least from the EIA and the IEA. But demand is created by the amount of trades that are placed upon something. It's algorithmic. So if you're starting to see traders put a bunch of options at $250 a barrel, you're going to see eventually the price of petroleum rise, just the way it is. If they start with $250 a barrel for a penny option, they're going to end up going to $10, $20, $30 options down at $100, $200, $150, $170. We are going to see that happen. It's the demand is already being built in through these you know, it's kind of ludicrous to put up an option for $250 a barrel of oil that costs $85 today. By the way, those options expire in June. So these are not they're in the near future, not in the distance. Now, when this type of stuff happens, and it does happen quite a bit, you'll start seeing other traders catch on. Inherently, human beings are God calls us sheep in the Bible, and sheep follow the flock. So as soon as there's a new idea that's put out there and someone thinks they can make money with it, others will pile on. I expect to see the weaponization of oil become a very big topic in this country through the summer. As we see more war mount, I think Israel came out today and said they will retaliate against Iran, but they're going to wait until May 1st. So they want to get through the holy days, which is respectable, I guess, in that case. But we want peace. Peace brings good prices. Peace brings stability in communities, societies, and nations, and economies. But when we start seeing these big trades coming in, you're going to see others follow, not to mention the fact you're going to see a big supply restriction. Russia has already committed to lowering their daily production by 9 million barrels per day. We're already at a 4 million barrel per day deficit. And I love talking to people who are unfamiliar with energy, because most of the time what our energy equation is this phone that we hold in our hands. That's what we think of as energy. And that just comes from a unicorn somewhere that drops it into a box. But the reality is that these things, these cell phones that we use every single day to run the cloud, that requires two times the amount of energy as the entire nation of Japan just to run the cloud. That energy comes from coal, oil, and gas. About 3% come from sustainable energy or wind and solar. We need wind and solar. We need more energy in the era that we're going into, approaching AI and quantum computing. Energy will be and has been and always will be the source of pain or profit in any business or any country. So when we look at these things from that perspective, we have to realize that if you can starve out a nation's energy, you can eliminate its ability to use technology. And if you can eliminate its ability to use technology, you can eliminate its ability to defend itself. This is all part of a massive overtaking that's happening right now as we hear more and more conversation about war and world war. If you haven't read Matthew 24, you certainly should. I think Jesus made an accurate prediction of the time that we live in. Wars, rumors of wars. We've seen all kinds of things that kind of align with Matthew 24. Now, in the midst of this, we have to look at the other energy sources, uranium. Uranium is going up. There are all kinds of things that don't make sense right now, like a ton of coca, of what it takes to make chocolate. costs $11,000 a ton. That is up, I think, 400% in the last 2 weeks. There's a lot of things that are happening out there. We just, last episode, talked about the copper supply shortage. Copper is the backbone. It is the lifeblood of technology. Without copper, you can't make phones, you can't make cars, you can't make anything. But pay attention to this, because as time moves on, I think that the weaponization of energy is going to become a very big topic, along with nuclear deterrence and restoring deterrence. I think these topics are going to be in the news cycle in the next few months. Now, we're also seeing things happen domestically that are a little scary, and they have to happen. One of them is bank friction. I did a show maybe 6-7 months ago talking about bank friction. Nobody knows what that means. Bank friction means creating more friction between you and your money. And there's a massive fintech market where about 60% of fintech is designed for banks to use this to make it harder for you to get your money out of the bank. That's what bank friction is and means. But it's now happening in real life. There is a video that came out of Canada where the bank teller gave somebody a hard time trying to take money out of the bank to go buy a car. I think they were buying a car. They put it all on video. So it was a million questions. And the guy said, "This is my money." And that's actually technically not true. When you're in a fiat system based on debt, which Canada is, just like America, technically the dollars in your pocket are Federal Reserve notes. You owe them to the Federal Reserve. I've talked ad nauseum about the Dodd-Frank Act and bailouts now being a thing of the past and bail-ins being the new reality if banks do collapse, which would mean that the bank gets to convert their debt to equity. Their debt is your money. They owe you money. You give them money, they hold it, they owe it to you. They can convert that into shares of their failed bank anytime they like, per the law. But we're starting to see this actually come to life in Canada. And I can speak to this because I raise capital. So every day of the week, someone is wiring our company money. And probably 3 to 5 times a week at our firm, we get calls from clients at their bank saying, "The bank won't let me wire you money." And we give them tell them it's your money and you can do what you want. It's actually a very difficult thing. So bank friction is becoming a real thing. Now, the banks were basically created as a system to be able to manage cash flow from the central banks. And the central banks print money and manage monetary policy. That's all they do. Now, we're seeing this now being put out by different economists, and I don't want to quote who they are or quote this as gospel because it's right now just a rumor. But there are massive rumors swirling in economist circles right now that the Biden administration greatly fears a bank run. And what they're going to try to do is make it more difficult for you to get money out of the bank. So that rumor kind of correlates with reality. But to this point in time, there's no official statement from the Biden administration about this. Not that that would matter. But it is certainly something to keep your eye on. Because a bank run by itself, statistically, banks don't have money. Go to a bank. If you're a wealthy person listening to this, go to a bank and try to take $100,000 in cash. They'll tell you to come. If you're at Wells Fargo, they'll tell you to come back on Thursday. And I know this for fact because we have clients that have asked these questions. They will tell you to come back on Thursday. That's when they get delivered cash. So if you think when you put cash in the bank, it sits in a vault waiting for you to take it out, it's not how it works. Statistically speaking, if 5% of Americans went to the bank, just 5%, and asked for all their money from the bank in cash, our banking system would collapse within a week. That's really how the system is built and designed. Now, the creator of all this, the person who gets creative credit for central banking, is always going to be the Rothschilds family, who ironically just put up their French chateau for sale today for $425 million. What a luxury it is to print fake money and become the richest man in the world. Well, we've seen multiple properties go up for sale by the Rothschilds and haven't heard of any new purchases. So something is definitely happening in the banking system that is far outside my knowledge to say with certainty. Again, just a guy in a hoodie giving you my observations. But I think it's something to watch. I've been talking about bank runs and bail-ins for such a long time. Never have I said that it's absolutely going to happen. I said that's how the law is structured. But now we're getting to a point where it's a possibility. And the whole purpose of this show is not to give you, I don't want you to look at me as someone to turn to. He knows I don't know everything. All I'm trying to do is give you as much information as I can so that you can determine the best decision for you to make. That's it. Now, moving on, Boeing. If you haven't heard of the Boeing debacle, you're probably living on a different planet. But Boeing right now has a real manufacturing issue, a real engineering issue with Boeing 737 and 787. And it's become such an issue. We've seen about 14 planes grounded in the past 2 weeks because of faulty engineering, panels on an engine, one of the engines on the wing falling off mid-flight, doors falling off. There are many different issues happening. Boeing is a government contractor. Boeing is extremely close to the money printer. The closer you are to the money printer, the wealthier you will be. That's how fiat systems with central banks work. But they came out today and made what I find to be one of the funniest statements in the world. Is Boeing came out today and said that they want to make flying cars by 2030. You can't make airplanes that stay in the air right now. Maybe you should focus in on that before working on building the Jetsons reality in 2030, which, by the way, is already 30 years too late. We're supposed to have flying cars in 2000. At the same time as the icebergs melting and all the beaches being evaporated, we're supposed to be able to fly away in our Jetson car by now, but I digress. Now, the interesting thing about this, the reason I keep bringing up closest to the money printer with central banks is because today, Congressman Waltz grilled a bunch of people on Capitol Hill. And this happens every day and nothing really seems to happen yet. But he basically held up a bag of bushings, which is just metal shaving struck. I don't even know what a bushing is. I looked it up on Amazon because he said, how much does this bag of bushings cost? And the guy didn't know. And he said, well, here's an invoice for $90,000. Looking at the bag, it looked like about 40 or 50 pieces of metal in this bag. So just being a normal guy, I went on Amazon. I looked up bushings, and I found that you can buy 6 bushings on Amazon for $13. So if we just use basic math and say there's 30 bushings, whatever that is, in a bag, we would be looking at a $65 purchase. So something that costs $65 on Amazon, the government is paying the military-industrial complex $90,000 for. There are examples of this all over the place. Pencils cost $14 per pencil. I can get a Ticonderoga pencil anywhere I want for 25 cents, but they pay $90 a pencil, $55 for a ballpoint pen. This is how money is laundered from a central bank and those closest to the printer out to their crony buddies. And in the middle of all of it, they laugh because they know that we're going to pay it off for them. That's simply how it works. I will harp on taxes and fiat structure and these things in every episode that we are in. So if you don't like hearing it, you might not want to watch the show. I just try to tell you the truth. Now, since we've gone from money into military-industrial complex, central banking, now we're getting into politics, a big part of the show. I don't get too into political swings. I don't care who you vote for. You're going to vote for whoever you think is best. Unfortunately, a lot of times you're led in the wrong direction. So the more factual information I can give you about money, politics, and religion, I think the better person you're going to be. And right now we're in the middle of a huge bill that I believe they're still debating about right now on Capitol Hill. It's Thursday the 18th, time of filming. This will be released tomorrow. But this is over FISA, FISA 702, Section 702. I talked about it in our last episode. This is essentially the ultimate state surveillance bill that's ever been passed recently. And the Patriot Act did a lot of that. But right now we're looking at FISA 702. What this bill does, essentially, is it forces everyone in this country who doesn't have a coffee shop, a hotel, or another exclusion. But if you're a gardener, if you're a tech consultant, if you're a house cleaner, the government can come to you and force you to spy on people. Now, I remember Netflix had a great show years ago called The Man in the High Castle. And I liked it. The first 2 seasons were great. After that, it got a little ridiculous, like most shows do. But it was essentially a show describing what America would be like if the Nazis won World War II. And if the Nazis won World War II, which I don't believe really ever ended, I mean, I can prove that in a million different ways, the fighting stopped, but the war of Nazis trying to take over the world didn't. And it's evidenced today in FISA 702. In Man in the High Castle, everyone was forced to be a spy to tell on everyone else to their local general who ran the military in their area, who would have people arrested for thinking the wrong thing, saying the wrong thing, doing the wrong thing, despite it not being illegal. So get on the phone with your congressmen and senators. This is a major topic. This is something that will destroy this country. There will be no free speech and no privacy. And those really are the 2 items that should be on the ballot for you as a human being, for anyone you vote for. Who gives me more privacy, more security, more safety, all these different things. But if you don't have that, you don't have free speech, you don't have a free nation. So 702 FISA, check into it. Now, Donald Trump is on trial, whether you like the guy or not, it doesn't really matter. I happen to love Trump. I think that he's a leader in this country that we need. I was not a huge fan of his, you know, when he first ran. I'll be honest about that. I didn't vote in 2016. I voted for him in 2020. It didn't matter because we had 150 million votes for 133 million registered voters. That's all I'm going to say about that, because I plan on staying on YouTube, but I won't play by your rules. I certainly won't when you're taking away views. Now, Trump is on trial for a plethora of things. The one thing you should take away from this, without judging whether the man did something or didn't do something, or whether it was legal or not legal or covered by, you know, presidential acts or not, you have to look at who is prosecuting and persecuting him. Every case that he is in, you can look at Fannie Willis in Georgia. You can look at the judges in New York. These are corrupt people who are politicizing, putting an opponent in jail. That is also a sign of a Maoist takeover. When you are allowed by law and you can embellish the law to put your political opponent in jail, you got a real problem in your country. I really, really could care less if you're a Democrat or Republican. I'm neither. I'm independent. And to be honest with you, we all should be. These political parties create doctrine that create unsound thinking that ultimately create bad societies. Now, what's interesting is they're still talking about Stormy Daniels. They're still, you know, promoting the story that he paid off Stormy Daniels for an affair. Stormy Daniels put out a letter, an officially notarized letter signed by her saying that she never had an affair with him and never took a penny from him. But yet these political hit jobs in these courtrooms persist. Again, whether you like Trump or not, imagine if that was your son, your brother, your uncle, your friend being persecuted for something that the person on the other side said never happened. This is the country we live in at the moment. Probably more succinct to the time is what's happening in Texas, Pennsylvania, and Missouri right now. These are the largest states for new registered voters. Great thing. You know, there's a faction in the world that says the voting system is rigged. Why would I participate? I can see their point. And there's other people saying we need to overwhelm the system to get the right people elected. I see their point as well. You make your own decision. But when you see states like Texas, Pennsylvania, Missouri, and there are a couple others, there are millions of people registering to vote without an ID. So how can that be happening, one might ask? Do we just miraculously have millions of people in this country who just are now deciding they want to register to vote? Maybe. More than likely, it has to do with the border crisis, which is a big topic we're going to go through today, because people keep considering the border crisis to be a different crisis than the economic crisis that we're in, and they're one and the same. And the long tail effects of this are far more devastating than you possibly have thought through. I have for weeks. Now, when you have anywhere between, because we don't know the number, 7 and 20 million new people in this country, many of which are from very hostile nations that hate America, why would they be here? And we're going to go through these things because I think it's a good critical thinking exercise to run through what's happening at the border mean. Well, number one, we're starting to see that there are a lot of people registering to vote without an ID. And I can't help but think that those are illegal citizens, illegal people in this country. I just can't help but think that. Not saying that's the case because I don't know. I'm not at a voter booth registering people. I have no idea who they are, but it's very suspicious with our timing. And I think it's something that we should have full transparency on with the government, because all of the states that I mentioned have a clause in their law that allows you to register to vote with just a Social Security card. And we do know that illegal migrants are getting Social Security cards. We do know that. That is not a theory any longer. Now, Mayorkas, who is the head of the DHS, who's in charge of the border, was just acquitted of an impeachment. Now, his impeachment, and I want you to think through our court systems. This is a very important thing when you're thinking about America and where to put money and what to do and how to take care of your family. Mayorkas was just accused of lying to Congress, and the Senate said, well, he didn't lie to Congress. He said that the border was secure, that everything was under control. I think every video, every conversation I've had with Border Patrol and every conversation I've had with anyone down at the border would disagree vehemently with that statement. He was acquitted on all charges. He's still the head of the Department of Homeland Security. And thankfully, some of our politicians actually grilled him today. This is a travesty that will have long tail effects far beyond what we think. So number one, let's go through this. I really want to go through two things to summarize this whole thing. Number one, the cyber threat in this country. I'm not a doomsday person. I don't believe that there is, what's the word everyone uses? You know, a Debbie Downer. I just try to deal in the reality and deepen my faith. I am not upset. I'm not scared about anything at all, because I know whatever happens to me on earth, you're going to threaten me with heaven if you try to take that away. But at the end of the day, we have a very serious cyber threat in this country, a border problem. And then there's a topic that keeps coming up. People keep asking questions about what is a Bitcoin halving? So I'm going to go through the border because I think the border is something we should all understand what's happening. Number one, there's a theory no more, and it's called the replacement theory. There are definitely people coming into this country from foreign lands who are not citizens who are registering to vote in an election for a candidate who is getting slaughtered in every poll. I think that's a very legitimate case to say this is no longer a theory. At the same time, we have a jobs report that keeps reporting that our jobs are growing every day. Those are primarily foreign-born people working part-time jobs. No Americans are getting new jobs. We're losing them. We've lost 74,000 full-time salary jobs in the last 18 days. That's the rate in which people are being laid off. But the real nefarious part of this to understand when we're looking at a Maoist or Marxist takeover of this country, by the way, Marxist is not a theory either. There are many people who post online that they're a professional Marxist. Mao learned everything he knows from Marx. And when we look at the whole history of a border crisis in any nation, we can see that each and every one of them, number one, culturally you change. Doesn't matter whether you want it to or not, America will never be the same. We have different cultures coming in here that'll intertwine in schools, and that's not necessarily a bad thing. I don't want to say that's a bad thing. I am a conservative. I do believe in conserving American values, which we're not conserving anymore. We need to gain them back. But I will say that the border crisis has much bigger implications than you might imagine. Number one, we have already spent $500 billion financing these people to come in. The nation of Guatemala, who has sent us illegals for their entire existence, the nation of Guatemala is now investigating NGOs. If you don't know what an NGO is, let me explain it to you pretty simply. It's a non-government organization that acts like the government, that gives tremendous tax benefits to billionaires who all in this day and age sort of seem like communists to me. And the nation of Guatemala is trying to get them out of their country because they're promoting to everyone that they should come to America and literally vote for Joe Biden. So the replacement theory is out the window. But who are these people? Guatemalans, no big deal. People from South America, not much of an issue. People coming from the Middle East and from Africa, which is primarily Muslim nations, is a problem. I'm not going to get too into it in this episode, but read the Quran, see what their intentions are for the world. Now, the intention of a Muslim is to place the world under Sharia law. And Sharia law is nothing you want to have part of in this country. I promise you that. There's no freedom in that. However, we are bringing people from hostile terrorist nations into this country. They have already built cells here. They started way before 9/11 began. The 9/11 was allowed because they already had cells and infrastructure and money built here. And that was 30 years ago. Now you have these heads of these terrorist cells that are in this country who need foot soldiers. And they are being sent to them through the U.S. government. The same government that tells you to pay taxes because they have your best interests in mind. Now, we have a weak head of the Department of Homeland Security that was just impeached. And the impeachment was denied on absolutely no logic. But let's look at the long tail effects. So let's just imagine this continues for another 4 years, another 5 years. We have one more, 6 months remaining in this election cycle. And let's just say the Biden administration pulls it off and they win, which you know exactly how they do it. 4 years, we would have 50 million migrants in this country. That's equivalent to a little under 1/6 of the existing population. Mind you, there are already more migrants in this country than the population size of 40 states. So there's only 10 states in this country that have more population than the amount of illegals in this country currently. Now, if we have 50 million illegals in this country, we can look at the very, very basic, simple things. Number one, the educational system will be thrown back 15 years. You have new languages, new literature, new culture to appease to, because that's what they do. They'll appease to it. Where American kids will learn of foreign cultures and call it American. It's a big problem. That takes decades, if not generations, to correct. Then you have the economic issue, which is already beginning. We've already spent taxpayer dollars to bring them here. In New York City, they're giving away $10,000 on visas. We have people from other countries who are protesting in New York City that their free accommodations paid on our bill aren't good enough for them. Like I said in our last episode, what happens when they pull that money? Really think about that. So you have terrorist cells that are being built in here. You have jobs that are being taken. What are the long tail effects? Well, over time, you're going to have 50 million new people in here that have to assimilate. They have to get jobs. That means that there's less jobs for your sons and your daughters. That means that there are less opportunities in schools for your sons and your daughters. That means that there is also going to be an overcrowding of cities, and rural areas will now be more populous than they desire to be, which is going to cause social anxiety and frustration. Ultimately, it's going to cause an upheaval, some sort of, something we don't want to deal with in the future, something we shouldn't have to go through, because push will come to shove. You also have to look at the supply chains. Last year, we had over 300 food processing plants that were burned down or blown up. Our food supply is already weakened. When you add 50 million new mouths to a food supply, you create a real bad situation. There are already 4 hospitals in this country that are getting ready to declare bankruptcy because they're going out of business because migrants are getting treatment and not paying for it. This is a reality already. Imagine 5 years from now, 4.5 years from now, with 50 million people chewing up medicine supply chains, food supply, hospital beds, treatment, time. Imagine the frustration that creates within a community and a society, the disdain that gets built for those who've taken from those who had. You know, Paul Harvey said it was, there's a great segment from 1963, Paul Harvey, If I Were the Devil. And since we have a pretty good scope on time, I'm going to pull that up and read it to you while we're right here, because everything that man said might as well have been a prophecy. Everything he said in here came true. The most pertinent part of it was when he talked about he would destroy ambition. So let's read, if I were the devil, if I were the prince of darkness, I would want to engulf the whole world in darkness. I'd have 1/3 of its real estate. I'd have 4/5 of its population, but I wouldn't be happy until I had seized the ripest apple on the tree, thee. So I'd set about however necessary to take over the United States. I'd subvert the churches first. I'd begin with a campaign of whispers. With the wisdom of a serpent, I would whisper to you as I whispered to Eve, do as you please. Does that sound familiar? Does that sound familiar in society? Share your truth. Do as you please. Follow your heart. To the young, I would whisper that the Bible is a myth. I would convince them that man created God instead of the other way around. Sounds familiar. I would confide that what is bad is what is good and what is good is square. And the old, I would teach to pray after me, Our Father, which art in Washington. We are seeing that definite effect on an older generation who still trusts in the system. Then I'd get organized. I'd educate authors in how to make more lurid literature exciting so that anything else would appear dull and uninteresting. I'd threaten TV with dirtier movies and vice versa. I'd peddle narcotics to whom I could. I'd sell alcohol to ladies and gentlemen of distinction, and I'd tranquilize the rest with pills. Have you seen any pharmaceutical commercials in the middle of your favorite show? We're going to go through that in an episode in a couple weeks about the way that pharmaceuticals are priced and why they run those commercials. If I were the devil, I'd soon have families at war with themselves, churches at war with themselves, nations at war with themselves, until each in turn was consumed. And with the promise of higher ratings, I'd have a mesmerizing media fanning the flames. If I were the devil, I would encourage schools to refine young intellects, but neglect to discipline emotions. Just let those run wild. Until before you know it, you'd have a drug-sniffing dog and a metal detector at every schoolhouse door. We have those now. Within a decade, I'd have prisons overflowing, which we do. I'd have judges promoting pornography. Soon I could evict God from the courthouse, then from the schoolhouse, then from the houses of Congress, which they just kicked God out of Congress. And his own churches, I would substitute psychology for religion and deify science. I would lure priests and pastors into misusing boys and girls and church money. If I were the devil, I would make the symbol of Easter an egg, the symbol of Christmas a bottle. If I were the devil, and this is the most important part, I would take from those who have and give to those who wanted until I had killed the incentive of the ambitious. What will you bet I could get whole states to promote gambling as a way to get rich? I would caution against extremes in hard work and patriotism and moral conduct. I would convince the young that marriage is old-fashioned, that swinging is more fun, that what you see on TV is the way to be, and thus I could undress you in public and lure you into bed with diseases for which there is no cure. In other words, if I were the devil, I would keep on doing what I'm doing. And if I were the devil, I would open up borders, and I would take from those who have, give to those who want it, until I killed the incentive of the ambitious, which is the ultimate, really nefarious goal of a mass migration of 50 million people over an 8-year period of time, is that ultimately what would happen with all these migrants in the middle of this country, fighting for jobs, fighting for food, fighting for housing, all these other things that steal from Americans, give to a foreigner, in the middle of this, you'd have increased traffic, you'd have massive anxiety, you would have young people who the jobs that these migrants are taking are usually designated for people in their teens and 20s that are learning how to build, you know, their lives, learning how to work, how to work hard for money. Money would be a very scarce item. Jobs would be a very scarce item. And in the end, those young minds that when they have time to breathe and time to think, innovate and create change and create technology and create massive amounts of social change, that ambition will be disincentivized. As I said in our last episode, the ultimate goal of a mass migration in a time like this is to ultimately kill the ability of a people to innovate. This has already happened in China. This has already happened. Communism kills innovation, steals faith, makes faith a government, trust in the government, don't trust in God, and you end up in this really bad situation. That is what I believe the end result of allowing this migration volume to continue will end up being, is a nation that can no longer innovate, that has to bend at the knee of the state. That's what's coming, if it's not stopped. Not to say it won't be. Now, another threat we have here, of course, the terrorism stuff is very real. Like, that's a very real thing. But we also have terrorists that use computers. This country has already gone through a series of cyber attacks that have been called all kinds of, I find, to be funny things. If you remember back a few weeks ago, AT&T was, you know, per the media, was hit by a solar flare from the sun, and only AT&T went out. T-Mobile was fine, Verizon was fine, Patriot Mobile was fine. All these other businesses were fine, but just AT&T was affected. Well, that's not possible. A solar flare would be an EMF, an electromagnetic field, or a pulse that would come from outer space. And in that process, it would take out every cellular company, not just one. So let's call that what it is. That's a cyber attack. We also just saw a barge boat loaded with shipping containers lose power, turn 90 degrees to the right, and impact directly at the falling point of a bridge, the keystone of the bridge, the one place in that bridge. There were two legs that bear weight. They hit one of them. The bridge collapsed literally within seconds of being hit by that boat. If you think that wasn't a cyber attack and it was just a guy falling asleep or whatever fallacy they've fed to us, please rethink your stance. I think there's a more critical thinking is required. We also just saw one that happened today, potentially. And again, I don't know. I'm just a guy in a hoodie, but I do know how cyber attacks work. The 911 networks in South Dakota, Nebraska, Nevada, Texas, Florida, Iowa, Kentucky, and Wisconsin were all out of commission for hours today with no explanation. There still has not been an explanation as to why the 911 emergency services went out today. But that seems like something that most people don't pay attention to until you need it, right? No one cares about 911 emergency services until you need 911. However, airlines need it. So Alaskan Airlines grounded their flights for almost the entire day today until this problem was solved. This is something we need to pay attention to. If you were looking at the plans of someone to overtake a free nation and a large economy, the easiest way to do it would be to cyber attack their banking system, shut down their banking system, and implement CBDCs for permanent tyranny. There is no other way around that. There is no other plan that would work because America is not going to vote for a CBDC. They'll have to have it imposed upon them, probably through a private company using stable coins or tokenization or some of these things. So it looks like no big deal. It's just the service provider. This is not just me saying this. There are many people who know a lot more than me that are saying the same things, which brings to mind our final topic. I'm going to wrap this up with two things. The Bitcoin halving. People keep hearing the Bitcoin halving and don't know what it means. Now, I was ignorant to Bitcoin for many years. And in 2022, when the rest of the world was researching conspiracy theories that you possibly can't prove ever, I was digging into understanding what it was because I heard nothing but it's a CIA problem or a solution, that it's an entrapment, it's all these other things, all these conspiracy theories. But I wanted to research what it really was, and I ended up meeting a lot of people who are really big into Bitcoin, and they were kind enough to answer my stupid questions for a very long time while I read books like The Bitcoin Standard and all these other things. I will do an episode. I'm not going to get into that today. But the Bitcoin halving, to understand the Bitcoin halving, you have to understand Bitcoin mining. Now, most people think Bitcoin miners are like a little, you know, Mario Brothers guy with a pickaxe digging through dirt looking for Bitcoin. That's not how it works. Bitcoin miners is a network of probably at this point in time, 40 to 50,000 different miners, millions of computing devices that have to solve a complex issue, which basically means that they have to have computing units that guess, you know, 500 to 600 million times every 10 minutes to be awarded from the system They have to put in work. They have to buy machinery. They have to build infrastructure. It's not just, you know, crony capital. You get Bitcoin and everything's fine. Bitcoin is earned. It's a meritocracy. It's what's called proof of work, which I'll do in a breakdown of Bitcoin and altcoins and the difference in the future. But for today's purposes, you should understand that Bitcoin miners are essentially a central bank. They are verifying that transactions don't have double spends and they're not fraudulent in any way. When they win the ability to get a block of transactions to verify, they verify it, and then all the other node holders have to verify also. When that happens, the Bitcoin network releases right now 6.5 Bitcoin. So for every block that I get the ability to mine and I verify and that the accounting is perfect, I get 6.5 Bitcoin. Keep it simple. What's going to happen here in the next day or two, it'll either be tomorrow, it'll be April 19th or April 20th. What happens is the system reward drops in half. So I've seen some funny things saying the Bitcoin halving means the price is going to drop in half, or that there's half of the amount of Bitcoin in the world and half of the Bitcoin will be, that's not it. There's 21 million Bitcoin. About 19.5 million Bitcoin are already in circulation. The last 1.5 million are difficult to mine, and they want to be able to make sure that you have the proper energy and infrastructure to do that. So all that's happening on the Bitcoin halving is, right now there are 900 Bitcoin a day that are produced. So the reward system for miners produces 900 Bitcoin per day. Whenever the halving occurs, either the 19th or the 20th, when that happens, there will now be 450 new Bitcoin issued into the market until the 21 million are released. That's all. Now, the importance of this is the scarcity. You know, there are only 21 million Bitcoin. Every Bitcoin breaks down into 100 million Satoshis, or small, pieces of a Bitcoin, because it is divisible. That is a rule of money, which I'll go through in that episode. Now, the thing that's interesting about this is that the other halvings always produce kind of a drop in the price and then a massive increase. Some of them 5,500%. I don't expect that. I expect maybe 200-300% in the next year. That's pretty in line with most analysts. However, we are in a different time. We are in a position right now where there are multiple ETFs putting multiple billions of dollars a day into Bitcoin. Hong Kong just authorized Bitcoin and Ethereum ETFs. I think Bitcoin is the only thing that should have an ETF based on security laws and security of the systems themselves. But when that happens, you have to look at supply. Just like any other commodity, Bitcoin, by the way, has full regulatory approval. I keep hearing it doesn't. It is literally considered by law a digital commodity. It's the first digital commodity. It's digital gold is what it's related to. And for some of you who know, gold destroys the Fed. Think about that. In the midst of this, you're going to go from an environment right now where there were 2.5 million Bitcoin available on the exchanges before the ETF. I think there's around 1.8 million available today. At this pace, all available Bitcoin that exists today would be bought up in about 18 months. And then you'd be living on a system where there's only 450 produced for the next 4 years. That'll drop down to 225 4 years from now. So the scarcity model is what people are talking about, is that Bitcoin is becoming more scarce because it's a finite amount. So when you hear Bitcoin halving and you hear people talking about it, you can know that the reward, the meritocracy built into proof of work systems, the reward people get for doing the work gets cut in half. So it's just cutting the daily supply from 900 to 450. And it will happen again in about 4 years, about every election season, a Bitcoin halving occurs. So through that, two more things to end on. Number one, Dubai. I think this is a great topic. Dubai is completely underwater. Now, there is so much wealth in that area of the world. That's where real trillionaires live, and they like rain. So for the last 40 years, these trillionaires have been paying airplanes to go up in the sky and dump chemicals into the air to produce rain. This is called cloud seeding. Many people call it chemtrails, which I constantly hear are a conspiracy theory. But in the nation of Dubai, they just flooded themselves through cloud seeding, which dumps chemical trails from airplanes into the air to create rain. So next time you see a straight line cloud in the sky, the news tells you that's called a cone cloud. I would like you to rethink that based on the evidence we have out of the nation of Dubai. Now, the two things I'm going to end on here today, number one, we go to Dubai. I just find that to be very interesting. I try to keep things light. It's not always financial. Financial today was pretty simple. We have a lot of interesting things happening. I think a lot more will happen tomorrow. But April 19th is a very big anniversary date in this country. It is the anniversary date of Lexington and Concord, the shot heard around the world. I find it to be a very interesting day correlating with a Bitcoin halving and all these other things that happen. But I think we should always remember that at one point in time, this country was in service to the King of England. and we were paying a very small tax that we killed a lot of people to get rid of. We're paying a much higher tax right now, and I think most Americans are getting tired of the system we live in. So really think back, you know, tomorrow, April 19th, really think back to that moment in history where we had to fight for everything that we have today, because we have to do the same thing again. We're just not going to do it with guns and bullets. We're going to do it with information. We're going to do it with politics. We're going to do it with unity. Eventually, this country will absolutely unify. So at the end of this, I know this is a lot of stuff. I know that this is a lot of things you haven't thought about, things that you may not care about, and things that you may not have heard before. All of it sounds bad. All of it sounds bad. Crashing economy sounds bad. Political corruption sounds bad. I haven't even gotten into the things that are actually bad, and you're already kind of shadow banning. There are many nefarious things that are happening right now. What's actually happening in the world for those of faith is God is shining the light upon the darkness. More and more people are starting to realize that our political system is corrupt, that our financial system is corrupt, that our judicial system is corrupt. And when you start to realize that, that's when change comes. So take this information, interestingly enough, with a grain of salt. I run a ministry. We talked about what did Jesus mean by saying that you are the salt of the earth? And we looked at all the different examples of salt. And one of them, after our meeting, a friend sent me a note saying, what about take it with a grain of salt? Well, that is actually an interesting thing to look up for yourself, because a grain of salt was included in antidotes for poison. So take things with a grain of salt. Don't let the world poison you on their bad news. Don't let me poison you with bad news, because I see all of this as good news. Financially, everything that's about to happen or that will happen or that could happen should have happened in 2009. We've been putting a Band-Aid on a bullet hole since 2009. It was inevitable to be in a difficult situation like we are today. When we step away, and I'm one of these, I said, well, politics doesn't matter in my day-to-day life. I don't need to worry about it. Well, we kind of do. That's the one thing that I've realized. I'm not a political person. I care less. I do care about my freedom, my sovereignty, and my family, and my ability to feed them. And those all come from laws. We have such a messed up system right now in this country that we didn't even know was this messed up 5, 10, 15, 20 years ago. It's been like this for a long time, everybody. But what's happening right now is the light is being shined upon the darkness, and darkness cannot exist in light. So take what I'm telling you with a grain of salt. Be the salt of the earth to everyone you know. Love your family. Hug them. Praise your Lord. Do the things you've got to do in this life, because change is coming. Change is on the way. Change cannot happen in the darkness. Tyranny happens in the darkness, and tyranny is running out of places to hide. So until next time, thank you all for your time today. God bless you all and your families. God bless this country, and we'll see you on the next Rice Report. Have a great night, everyone.